Academy of Architecture in Madrid, the Architectural Association in London, and at the Universidad Politécnica de Catalunya in Barcelona. He curated the exhibition Yona Friedman, Genesis of a Vision, at the APFL Archizum Gallery in 2012. So I'm gonna now leave the stage to Mr. Manuel Orazi and Nader, that will introduce better than me Mr. Yona Friedman. So welcome to the Global Lecture 2016 Barcelona.
Thank you very much. First of all, it's a very new experience for me, I think for Yona and Manuel also, to be connected like this. I would like to begin by thanking you, Aldo Salazzo, director of the GSS program, and also Eduard Cabé, architect and teacher at the IAC Barcelona, that I met in London when I was studying. Exactly 1 year ago from today, this book, The Dilution of Architecture, was released by Park Books in Zurich and was originally published in, as you said, in conjunction with the exhibition of Yona Friedman, Genesis of a Vision, which was presented at the Archizum Gallery at the ENAC faculty at the APFL in Switzerland in 2012. I had personally the honor to conduct both projects as a curator and editor, and collaborating with both Yona Friedman and Manuel Orazi, sorry, was a tremendous lesson for me as an architect
curator.
As a researcher. Is it fine?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Addressing topics that are dear to Yona Friedman, such as society, politics, European metropolis, and the city in general, the first part of this book brings together a large number of projects and proposals by Yona Friedman into a classified ontology that he called The Dilution of Architecture. The second part of the book presents a comparative essay by Manuel Orazi that reconstructs the many facets of Yona Friedman's work since his formative years. The intention here for this publication was not to do to present a catalogue of projects that have crossed the century, but remains an attempt to unveil the origin of the revolutionary thought of this author that is very contemporary today. Friedman's work is situated in a very particular time. As Vittorio Orelli mentioned in Archit in 2003, in 1963, the Greek architects and urban planners, Doxiadis, and some researchers from different disciplines and fields, including Marshall McLuhan and Bruckmeister Fuller, met aboard a small cruise ship sailing for 8 days in the Greek archipelagos. They discussed how the network phenomenon, visible and invisible, has reshaped the world in a kind of global village, and how, somehow, the evolution of communication systems, this is where we stand now, has allowed the world to take, accordingly, the typical behavior of a village. Within this paradigm was born the idea of the new urban visions, which found in networks the key unit of the evolution of the city, where technology and communication are inextricably linked in a construction project of a possible city. It's a futuristic vision which is basically perpetuated the prerogative of the modern project, but which tended to build continuous hybrid being. Yona Friedman's work lies precisely within this controversy, mainly as a critical attitude toward the hegemonic forms that were in this time the idea of a global city. His work foresees the creation of a possible place, therefore an equilibrium between a project and the desire for another reality. His contribution is mainly related to the principles of architecture, whose purposes are to understand the continuous change that characterizes social mobility. An architecture that is based mainly on infrastructure that provides housing and urban norms subject to be created and recreated accordingly to the needs of the residents. He became famous at the time known as the megastructure with his special city. Even if I know, Mr. Friedman, that you find this verb as a ridiculous nonsense, and contributed to definitely challenge the audacious wishes of architecture and urban planning of the modern era. Its architectural conceptions comes from the fact that it must be realized by the users, by the inhabitants only, and that the architect, as a mediator, as a translator, can provide some guidance for the implementation. Thus, basing his studies mainly on this idea of architecture as a process rather than a form object, he proposes an architecture that promotes communication even before producing a tectonic form. Then after, he introduced this concept of the groupe critique opérationnel, the critical group, in which a maximum number of people with whom communication can take place without being deformed. In this sense, the critical group represents an idea of the city, not on a limitlessness of space, but its measurability. Measurability, therefore, becomes a possible and practical instrument of the project that is mainly based on the individual's ability of relating to the world. It is precisely within this notion of measurability that since the 60s, he offers what is called the city continent, or metropole Europe, metropole Europe. Cities are not governed by a central system, but have their own autonomy, and the entire Europe is considered as a gigantic city-state system. Massimiliano Cacciari in Archipelago of 97 also talks about Europe as a urban entity. Once determined the cities that are consisting of private and superposed, juxtaposed dots, he pushes his analysis toward a supra-territorial definition, extending the reasoning across the entire Earth's surface. First, the city continent, and then the global continent. The city continent, based on the development of a high-speed transport network, was born as a future alternative urban development scenario to the megalopolis. This development would lead to the development of the natural creation of a series of medium and large cities linked and connected by a network and separated by a countryside hinterland. This configuration has been theorized in the 70s and is now close to the current configuration of Europe with its various directives and its high-speed lines. I would like to stress the following, personally, on the opposite, I think, of Jonah Friedman's thinking process, and somehow in relation to your program's title, we can address and reflect about this notion of architecture hypology or hyperology. The hypercity is the globalized city. Kevin Robotham argues that it is absolutely paranoid because it requires that global connections be established, and totally neurotic because it demands that all aspects of the contemporary city are simultaneously and instantaneously available. Paul Virilio, in his book Vitesse and Politique of 97, translated in English Speed in Politics, is probably the only critical urbanist to speculate on the conditions of communication speed as the primary paradigm of city form. He claims that the shape of the city relies upon its strategy for defense rather than upon its strategies for the spatialization of commercial activity. The contemporary situation, which has seen the creation of the spread city, and most particularly the assimilation of major cities into extended metropolitan field, known casually as metropolis, results directly from the obviation of urban defense against external attack. If destruction is instantaneous and total, defense is irrelevant. Citing also Sun Tzu with the following quote, speed is the essence of war. Cities, once a kind of denser of human activity and cultural production, traditionally resisted easy penetration at the perimeter. Today, they attempt to facilitate increasingly fluid connections between fields of urban concentration. The edge of these fields are indistinct, and time distances between them are increasingly reduced by the growing speed of inter-metropolitan communication. So in the sense, the freeway is the key adjunct to the modern perimeter-less metropolitan field. It connects a line of communication and extension between concentrated urban fields, facilitating the fusion. The freeway is the line of transcendence along which the consequences of a paranoid and neurotic urban ID can flow. Some signs of this hypology already exist. For instance, the projects of two radical Italian groups of the late 60s, Archizoom and Superstudio, projected the end game of this insane and compulsive extension of the city as a continuous building. The project improvised a fragment of the hypercity displaying its key feature, which are the continuous and extensible floor plate, ground plate, at the contrary of Friedman's span over blocks and spatial city that have a very light footprint on the ground, the incorporation of existing structures, particularly building, which are seen to have some enduring value within a single containing volume, and the shift from a series of cellular volumes with single containing volumes with the corporate glass facade matrix at the contrary of the ville facade, at the ville spatiale that has no surface and no facade. Now where are we in this moment? All of us, we are in a globalized era and in multicultural countries. We are in international cities and in neighborhoods in mutation. So it seems very appropriate in this notion of hyper cities to ask and raise the question of the local, the neighborhood. As wrote by the anthropologist of globalization, Arjun Appadurai, the local doesn't define itself spatially but contextually. It is crossed from all sides by flows of informational order, economic or cultural streams that reshape it and constantly redefine it. The local is irrevocably linked to other places, sometimes close, sometimes at the other end of the earth. You can find this text on the production of locality, chapter 9, published in his book Modernity at a Large, Cultural Dimension of Globalization, 1996. Because it is set and affects a context that goes far beyond the territory, and because it is both real and virtual, the local is now hyperlocal. The hyperlocal is very interesting and is that links and transition to somewhere else. This is also the reduced dimension, densified and intensified, of the everyday daily space. It is a space where the intervention of the users is not only possible, but also essential, since only them can really give an identity to the place. And this is how I would allow myself to link it with terms of participations that are very cherished term for Yonah Friedman. If the hyperlocal is a contested space, subverted by flows and by streams that pass through it, is it also the space of all possible? It is the space of the citizen participation by excellence, since it is that of daily challenges and issues. This is where the life, the activity, and the social relations materialize. I have never been able to visit one of the Five Labs programs, but from the original definitions of the fabrication laboratory from the MIT, the program was initiated to broadly explore how the content of information related to its physical representation and how an underserved community can be powered by technology at the grassroots level. So therefore, the Fab Lab is definitely hyperlocal, and the concept is very interesting. Now, before giving the floor to Manuel Orazzi and then Jona Friedman, I would like to express my best wishes of success to all of you for your future as urban professionals or as laymans. And I'm looking forward to discover your production during this summer school in particular. Thank you.
Thank you, Nader. Thank you, Nader. Thank you. So, Manuel?
Yes.
Remember how to share your screen if you want to present something?
Yes, yes. Okay. I hope you can hear well.
I can hear you perfectly.
Okay. I worked on the work of Jona Friedman for many years. I met his work the first time as a publisher when in 2003 we did the Italian edition of Utopie Realizzable, that means feasible utopias. And then I met him in Florence for a conference in 2004, and I decided to do my PhD. Jona helped me very much, sharing his archives in his Paris apartment. And what I liked, what I the most, is the fact that he is a producer of thinking. He is an architect who thinks, which is quite rare nowadays. Usually architects follow fashion in architecture, I mean. And no, in this sense, Jona has always been autonomous and has always cultivated the same fil rouge. I would say he has some constant interest and constant concept like participation, autoregulation, etc. So my PhD, my work is the second part of the book, as you know, is something that can help in know the context of the work of the long career of Jona Friedman, who started just after the war. He was present in the last SIAM, or International Congress of Modern Architecture in Dubrovnik in 1956, when the TIN came out, when he had the pleasure and the chance to meet some allies like German architects, and also Giancarlo De Carlo, Georges Candilis, who was working in Paris, and then the GEAM, the group de l'architecture mobile, d'études de l'architecture mobile that he founded in Paris. I'm going to show you briefly a small. This is my part of the book, as you can see, The Erratic Universe of Jona Friedman, because Jona had the chance to live and work in three continents, because he was born in Europe, in Hungary, but then was in Palestine and then Israel for 10 years, so in the Middle East. Then he went to Paris in 1957, and then he started teaching in the United States in 1964. That means that he has, and then again in the 70s, he could work for, started working for the UNESCO in Paris, who gave him the possibility to visit and work in Africa, Asia, and South America. So he's really a global architect, and I think he is. He can speak with whoever of our of the participants to this discussion. Of course, I try to reconstruct very far away experience and teaching he could take from, for example, Werner Heisenberg, a physicist, a German physicist who was teaching in Budapest. And then, I mean, the my thesis is divided in three parts. The first is about the formative years in Hungary, and then in Israel. And the second part is about the interest in technology and the ville spatiale, especially with the project and the vision, the most known among among his work. And then there is a part about the third part is more focused on participation and auto-regulation. So it's about his more mature work and his more mature books, like L'architecture de survie, The Architecture of Survival, and Feasible Utopias, as I said. So what I mean, what I was more interested about, it was very good for me to discover also other parts of his work, like the work on prefabrication, the abri cylindrique that you can see here, for example. It was a part of his work developed in the Middle East for temporary housing for refugees, because Yona knew personally the experience to be a refugee. That is an issue that dramatically today it is so actual in Europe, as you know, but there is a constant issue of humanity. By the way, this special work was developing in the 50s in parallel with the first experimentation on l'architecture mobile, la ville spatiale, was very much put him in contact with Jean Prouvé in France, who was a hero of the modernization and of the modern architecture in France. As you know, Jean Prouvé collaborated very much with Le Corbusier, who remains the hero of Yona, and that Yona Friedman could meet personally in Paris in the 50s and 60s. Here you can see here up the a prefabricated house by Jean Prouvé, and this is a collage of Yona of the 50s, which are concrete boxes one on another. And this is the same idea that Moshe Safdi took, for example, for the Expo in Montreal in 1967. So just to say that all very often ideas travel and have a very quick diffusion, but also it is interesting how how, and it is important how ideas could be adapted and taken personally in different contexts. Yona Friedman has been always a great producer of ideas, and of course other there were important collaborations of Yona, for example, with the German engineer and architect Konrad Wachsmann, who taught in the Technion in Haifa, the city where he finished his studies and he took his degree in Israel. And you know that Waxman was an expert of joints and was also very important for the Japanese metabolist, even if the work of Yona came before the work of the metabolist in Japan. So I tried to reconstruct a very wide range of experience, of studies, of experimentation, and many experience and contacts with a large amount of people, because Yona Friedman has constantly taught in several universities, has organized several and several exhibitions all around the world, so had the chance to meet, face a very wide range of architects and theorists. So it's difficult for me to summarize all this kind of experience, but if I can it can take your attention to this document, for example, which is a document wrote down and presented in the SIAM of Dubrovnik of 1956, as I told you. Maybe you can see, if I don't know if I can, I'm trying to make a zoom. Can you read it?
Pretty much.
Not much?
Well, more or less.
Okay, I try to read. This document to me is revolutionary because Yona Friedman wrote the year is 1956. He is talking about the settlement revolution. User determination makes settlements work. User determination is better than governmental planning. User determination solves problems governments cannot solve. The settlement revolution is a vote by acts. Users do what the character caretakers did not do for them. Settlement problems cannot be solved by others than by the effective users. Information as a primary school at primary school level is necessary to enable and to encourage users to rely to themselves for solving their problems. Agriculture in cities should be promoted to assure survival in case of emergency. Recognition of the urban village as a political entity is necessary. I think that these are all statements still revolutionary in architecture, and for some in somehow they're also they could be defined like anarchic, because they clearly don't have much trust in government planning, for example, for sure. And and I think that was this. They are still very, very actual and quite revolutionary statements. And maybe we'll have the occasion to ask directly to Yona what he think about this. But as I told you, just to
one second, Manuel.
Yes.
Manuel, one second. Manuel. Beijing, please mute locally. Beijing, mute locally your microphone. Beijing. Okay. Go on. Thank you, Manuel. You can go on.
Okay. Fine. Now it's okay?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. And The Settlement Revolution, to me, is a very important document that I could find in the Getty Center, where I found him. I think that in the last, 15 years, let's say, the work of Yona has been rediscovered also by the contemporary art, because you know that Hans Ulrich Kvist, for example, but many other, Daniel Birnbaum, Yona was present in several Biennale of Arts, of Visual Arts in Venice, but also in the Documenta at Kassel and in other important international museums. Then it was now, more recently, he has been, his issues that he worked on for several years are now on the agenda. For example, in the last Open Biennale by Alejandro Aravena in Venice, reporting from the front, is facing a lot of issues of about autoconstruction and participation that Yona described and worked and very clearly in his work, like in the book, as I said, Utopie Realizable. I think, in general, what I like the most about his work is that he's a producer of concepts. Concepts and theories, it's not true that they are abstract. They can be very concrete, very actual, like instruments. When Yona is talking about the urban village or the critical group, is not only making a critique to Europe as a content city, it's not only a description of the actual situation of cities and all their working, their functioning. It's also giving us a very concrete point of view face the contemporary problems of cities. To be aware of the fact that cities are not continuous but are actually divided into urban villages could allow us to work on cities in a very different way. Surely in a less dogmatic way, like urban planning has been traditionally and still now. For me, the work of Yona is so rich and heterogeneous, which that is a kind of minery we reconstruct. You can really find in his long work and in his big work the instruments to face the main problems of architecture and the city of the contemporary city and the contemporary architecture. So I would like to finish an appreciation, but I would like also to show you briefly, if I am able, one thing. Usually, when I do my lecture with my students, I finish with two images, especially this one that Yona showed me a few years ago. This image is an image of the 20s, probably 23, 24, when Yona was born. It's about a Russian constructivist architect, Lazar Hidekel, who was imagining a ville spatiale. And there are other possible examples of the past, of course, But I mean, what I want to say is this: that the big dimension, the idea to work on the city, like the idea of the ville spatiale, the densification of city without the destruction of or the demolition of the existing cities below, I want to say it is a beautiful and fascinating idea that was present also in the roots of modernity, of modern architecture. So this image Jona showed me, of course, it discovered this image many years after, I think in the 80s, but it's not a problem of influence, it's a problem of that problems of the city and architecture comes back. Like Nietzsche used to say, is the eternal going back of problems. So we should care very much not only about the projects by Jona, but also about his theoretical work, which is done by many books, because they really can help us to face our problems in Tehran, in Moscow, in Macerata, and Barcelona, I hope. So. This book is not the definitive book, of course, but it's just an invitation to discover a precious and very extremely rich work by a unique figure in the constellation of modern architecture. Thank you.
So, with me there is also Edouard Cabet that made all of it possible, connecting all of us. And here is Edouard. And I think it's the moment now to introduce Mr. Jona Friedman and leave space for his words. So we can... Now you can. It's your turn, Mr. Friedman. We are ready for you.
I want first of all thank Nader and I am and particularly I am glad that Manuel was talking about Hideckel, the work of whom I learned about 20 years ago when I was in Moscow. But I think my role is now not to talk about what is in the book, but what I did after. So I am trying to be an updating. You see, there are different concepts I would like to. There is important change with the city. I had visitors from London this morning, and we are told about that. What changed the concept of proximity. You know, the city all the time was based on ideas of proximity. It had to be concentrated because the defense in the new age because of the networks, electricity, etc. Today, all this changed very sudden with the modern technology. First of all, the proximity, I am speaking with you now, I think 1,000 kilometers from here, and okay, there is no limit, there is no necessity for proximity for the telephone, I have it in my pocket, there is no necessity for the networks, the electricity, but my phone is not linked to a physical network, doesn't take electricity of the physical network. Water and gas is delivered by when you are commanding it by internet. You don't need any more the proximity. So you are now my neighbor. It's really quite fantastic. Then for social meetings, you know, I am always telling this. When I was a student, I was told there is forum is important, people meet in the marketplace, that's finished. If I am going to the supermarket, I am not talking with anybody. If I am going, if I am not having it by phone. My social meetings are not anymore random. I have it my pocket phone, phoning to somebody, and we appoint and to meet, not necessarily in a forum, not necessarily in a market, anywhere. So all this thing, the proximity, changed the concept. There is no necessity of the concentrated city. A second thing, there is no necessity of planning. Everything can be improvised. I can meet somebody by internet without having an appointment and date and everything. So I can improvise everything. And this is what I find a very important new element. Improvisation became an important part of planning and of architecture. Already, the Ville Spatiale was based on it, that improvisation is done by the inhabitant. It's not planned by the architect. Actually, I got farther than the Ville Spatiale in the beginning. The structure is improvised too. I was doing a few weeks ago in London at the Serpentine Gallery a small pavilion. The important in it that I didn't make drawings for it. I was making a small model and they were building it after that. They improvised the technique. We did this in Italy, in many places. Improvisation is a new concept in architecture. Improvisation by the inhabitant, this was the starting element of the mobile architecture. The improvisation can go till the last element in the techniques. That's new. And you see, very often young architects ask me, if everything is improvised, what is our role? So the architect gets a new interpretation. First of all, he has to know about social reality, accept social reality. That's not the same thing like planning. Not impose a social pattern, but let it. But the second thing, what is new and what was forgotten, that's the architectural art. If I am looking at most avant-garde buildings today, they are sculptures, but very mediocre sculptures. But architecture is not sculpture. It has an inside. That's the difference. And that's what's important for the architect. I am telling that way the architect as an artist is the sculptor of the void, sculpting the empty space, and that's new. So we arrived to a different concept, the city chain, because of the proximity, the social attitude chain, because it's the inhabitant who can improvise his environment, and it can become a new kind of art, sculpting the space, sculpting space. And so that's what I feel today as a program, and it's an opening. The trade changes in a way. And the reason that very often young architects like it, because what does to an architect getting out of school today, goes to a big office and works there like a small bureaucrat. But if in the principle what I am telling, he becomes creative, creative socially, creative artistically. And I will come to another point what I consider important. That's communication. You know, it is an important element for every activity, how to communicate with the other part, whoever it is. And there are problems today. Technology alone doesn't solve communication. You have to invent the language. The technology transfers the language, but doesn't talk for you. And I was trying, and till now it works quite well, combine talk with drawing, very simple drawings, you see, and different programs. It's a book that came out now. It's about 100 communication, I am calling them slideshows, which are included. By the way, Manuel Orazzi knows it because it's his French partner who came out. But I think that's important. And what I am trying, instead of being on a screen a talking head, I prefer to use this type of sequences of drawings with text. This was translated even in Chinese. It's very easy to translate because very little text to it. And I think this is important. And what I was telling about the space, I can show as well with old drawings what I am finding, a new kind of space. They are old drawings, but this is not a sculpture. The vis spatial, you can see from the inside, and it's not sought for the outside. It has no facade, no elevation. It has only inside. And now in several real cases, I used to it. So this is the continuation of the, if you want, of the idea of 57 about mobile architecture, and it developed. And another thing, Manuel was talking about that I had the influence of physicists, I had the influence extra architecture. Now it is the other way as well. I have an influence on non-architects. You know, all these limitations of fields, it's over. We became far, far larger. And what I am telling in architecture, it's often useful for the physicist, but the physicist finds it's useful for me to conceive my project. And the same thing I can tell about the biologist. We are not separate intellectual domain. We are thinking people. And one of the projects I am now amused to work on, what's an idea, we are speaking always about artificial intelligence. I am posing the question, artificial imagination. And it is possible. It is mathematically possible. It's a lot of work to do it. I am not competent enough to work it out. But it's again an opening. So my real interest is always in opening. But in this opening, I am as well continuing a line which started before I was born, like the project of Kidecker. And I think that we have to understand all intellectual activity as an element in a long chain, not unrelated backwards and not unrelated forward. And that's really the message I would tell in this talk. I am not speaking only to architects, and I am not speaking not for any trade. I think thinking and intellectual activity is all fields, and you cannot be a detailist in all fields, but you can be a conceptor in many fields. Manuel in the book mentioned the influence of Heisenberg for me. The influence was that Heisenberg told that Goethe was in a way the inventor of modern concept of light, and that's important, that a physicist like Heisenberg tells that a poet is inventor. So I think that's what I feel important. We are in all fields, and we cannot plan. Not planning, that's not that we leave it to random, but simply it escapes us. We cannot direct things. And I was asked these days about the Brexit from London. They were asking what I'm thinking. And I answered, it's a crisis of democracy if quasi 50% people imposes for the other 50 something what they don't want. Why not formulate a question that permits a compromise? That means, for example, if a territory don't want the Brexit, they should stay. If another territory wants to get out, get out. You see, the democracy, political democracy today, it's a Western dictatorship, majority dictatorship. I accept the majority is very large, but the nearly 50% majority imposing to the on the order. I am not speaking now because of Brexit, only it's a good illustration what is absurd. And when I started mobile architecture, I was telling the average man doesn't exist, there are only individuals. And for me, that's the democracy. And that was what I was trying with the Vespasiel, and that's what I am trying with my work now. And communication as well. It's not for the average man, it's for you. You understand it as you want. So this is what I am telling, a sort of summing up and a provocation for the to continue. Okay, so I am trying open the door. I'm sorry, you know I don't hear, so it's very difficult to answer to questions, but you can write it and I can answer. Okay, so thank you.
Thank you.
So, as Mr. Friedman said, if there is any question, we should write it. I can, Manuel, probably you can help me with this. Do you have any question from your side? I can write some question here in the chat.
Okay. No, I wanted to make a question about Brexit, but you already talked about. But I think it's more interesting. I have a question about confederation. In Utopie Réalisable, he wrote 40 years ago that he doesn't trust federalism and federation of states because federalism produces wars. Is he still thinking and can explain us how? I can write the question.
You believe?
Yes.
Yes. I'm writing.
One of the problems is because this abstract words, that's an abstraction, federally or whatever. You know, if I need to explain a point, I am explaining that the language killed by the over extraction. To give you an example, I was asked somebody that how did I draw the concept of freedom. So I was saying freedom, there is freedom to talk, freedom to eat, freedom to vote. It's always concrete. The abstract freedom, it's meaningless. I am free to talk,
Okay. So I just want to I don't know if there is any question from the audience. Okay, there is one.
Stuff. In this book, there's a part about utopia and Zionism.
Utopias and
Zionism.
Do you want to write?
She probably is better.
Bonjour, Monsieur Friedman. In this book. J'ai pas compris. Utopie 2.
Israel after the meant a freedom, but as I see from the there is a 50-50 majority. I think exactly what I told you about the democracy. But there are two differences to exercise. For me, a utopia is made. And utopia is interesting if it's realizable. And that's another realizable utopia. I am defining that idea that has consensus. Consensus, that means 100% majority. If there is 50% people unhappy with the system, and 50% who are happy, that's not that long 50, but in for all points. And a democracy where it's not the election that matters. Really, if you want to support mutual respect, and the question is something. Animals have it. In a group of animals, there is nobody who comments. There is a behavior. Group of animals. Animals who don't like, they won't make another. That means to learn from the animals to realize that.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Friedman. You talk about technology, you talk about you know how the age of separated knowledge is over. Mr. Friedman also said that knowledge can be seen as a continuous chain, no, strictly connected, where each piece is adding value to the entire system. We talk about democracy, we talk about politics. So it was a very, very fresh and contemporary talk. I'm speechless, to be honest. I always loved your work, but it was very beautiful to listen to your words. And I feel lucky of this opportunity. So again, thanks to Eduard for making all this possible. And I want now to close the lecture by saying that this lecture has been streamed live in Beijing, Tehran, Barcelona, New York, Beirut, and also Beijing. So also this lecture has been recorded and is available on our YouTube channel. And for sure we will promote and try to diffuse as much as possible your precious words among our network of students and researchers. So thank you in name of the name of IAC, the Institute for Advanced Architecture of Catalonia. Thanks to Eduard, thanks to Manuel, thanks to Nader, and absolutely a special thanks to you, Mr. Fitman. It will be I will be reading this amazing book. So I have what to do in this summer. Thanks and goodbye. See you soon. This is our audience.
Bye.
Bye. Ciao.
Ciao. Ciao, Manuel.
Ciao, ciao.
Ciao, ciao.
Je vous le ton.
Oui, je les laisse jouer. Bye. Peut-être qu'ils peuvent se parler.
Is Nader still there?
Yeah.